Howdy, gang. Thought I'd take a little walk with y'all after consulting with my team. I learned that you can connect more directly and earnestly with your audience if you produce more casual content. So this is me just speaking off the cuff. Definitely wasn't scripted beforehand. So let's talk 2020. Now, I know some people are like, oh, it's too early to talk about the next election. And my counter argument to that is that those people are silly and also privileged. I realize that I am privileged in many ways, but what I mean by privilege in this particular case is that these are people whose stress and anxiety is related directly to the election cycle, whereas my stress and anxiety, and I'm sure many of yours as well, is directly related to the current state of the political climate and the fear that we are just going to keep repeating our same mistakes over and over and over again. In other words, my fear is of the status quo writ large vis-a-vis deja vu. So I do want to talk about 2020, as well as some, you know, municipal and gubernatorial elections that are happening in 2019. Shout out to comptrollers and shit. Because that's our next opportunity to escape this disgusting nightmare hellscape that we are continually existing in day after day. But before we get into that, let's clarify something about 2018. It was a good election for the Democrats. I'm not saying it was great, but I am saying that much like the artist in its best picture race in 2011, it was good enough. It did what it needed to do. But even still, there are a lot of people who are despondent, who, you know, were sort of expecting nothing less than a blue tsunami, a blue Hurricane Harvey, a blue day after tomorrow, after which all of the regressive Republican Party policies would just disappear. And that was never gonna happen, and here's why. For one thing, the map was completely stacked against us. All the House seats are gerrymandered, and we still managed to take the House, and the Senate map only had a few Republican seats to choose from and like a whole bunch of Democratic seats to win, and even still we managed to only lose two seats and overall win 69% of the Senate seats that were up. And I know what you're thinking, and I agree, nice. Another thing to consider is that a lot of people got really politically engaged after 2016, which has been fantastic. But that also means that their political memories only extend as far as that fateful November 8th. And so, they believe that the 2016 election happened overnight. But the 2016 election did not happen overnight, even though technically it did happen overnight. The Republicans had already been making gains for the last decade. The Tea Party movement, the birther movement, the alt-right as we know it, were already percolating powerlessly for years and years and years. They already were 30 to 40% of the country. They just happened to be the 30 to 40% of the country that didn't have the presidency. But in the meantime, they were getting state legislatures, governorships, House seats, Senate seats. They were blocking judicial appointments. And as soon as they got any power, they began systematically making efforts to prevent Democrats from winning in the future through voter ID laws and purging voter rolls and redistricting and things like that. And by the way, this is why it's so good that the very first thing the House Democrats have proposed upon coming into power is the expanding of voting rights legislation. That's a huge deal. We absolutely need to be campaigning on that if we want to have lasting power in the future. But anyway, we didn't really notice all these things were happening, or at the very least we didn't feel the existential threat of them, because at the very top of this simmering volcano was a little Obama bobblehead that made us feel better about everything. And so, when the volcano erupted, Obama flew out and Trump popped in, we thought to ourselves, where the fuck did all this lava come from? When in reality, we should have been asking, hey, isn't it interesting that the Republicans are gathering all of this magma? Hashtag put on your magma hat. And so, by the same token, the progressive movement is going to need a little bit more than one election to get all the victories we want. That's why the key word is progress in progressive and not, say, instant gratification. Am I gonna get hit by a car? Doesn't look like it. That's great news. Power begets power, but the corollary to that is that if we're going to get more power, we need to have some power in the first place. Is that making any sense whatsoever? What I'm saying is that we got the victories we needed to start building a bigger movement in the future in 2018. So, anyway, 2020. I don't know if you know this, very important election. You know, we're going to be voting on whether Trump is still in office. We're going to be voting on a whole bunch of other, you know, House seats and Senate seats and gubernatorial elections and things like that. But also, crucially, as I kind of implied earlier, this is the last election before the 2020 census numbers are thrown in. And so that means that redistricting is coming up as well. And so whoever wins this election is going to be in charge of how power is distributed for the next 10 years. Kind of a big deal. So how are we going to win in 2020? The same way that we did in 2018. Through progressive, unapologetic candidates who don't take corporate money and things like that. And by leaving no stone unturned, by running them for every single office possible. Do not let a single county in this country go without a town hall. Who can we put at the top of the ticket who's going to be able to accomplish these things? And I am walking in circles because, I don't know if you can tell, but I'm kind of like on a median here and there's cars potentially running over me from all directions. Maybe after the next jump cut, I will not be in that situation. Every candidate that has gotten some kind of buzz for 2020 has some kind of Achilles heel that they're dealing with. Kamala Harris has her history as California's Attorney General. Kirsten Gillibrand has some gun stuff. Cory Booker has some pharma stuff. Elizabeth Warren had her epic unforced error Native American heritage gaffe video. Bernie Sanders has some issues with, you know, we'll call them wacky, semi-racist comments. Not full-on racist, just a little bit of the borderline racist. And also, every verified Twitter user seems to be out for his blood, so that's kind of a disadvantage. And then Joe Biden has his entire career. So, we need someone who doesn't have baggage, who's able to excite the base without scaring off the establishment too much. Ideally doesn't take PAC money. Somebody who, you know, gets people excited based on their integrity and their policies and their personality even, but just not the fact that they're not Trump. That can't be the number one selling point about them. And also, it wouldn't hurt if they were able to pull a swing state through for your boy. When they stand next to Trump on the debate stage, is able to draw eyeballs to them rather than to Trump to see his reaction. Because that was something that all of Trump's opponents were missing in the 2016 election. None of them had the it factor, except for Ted Cruz, who had an it factor. Bandejo. The one potential candidate I can think of who I truly believe exemplifies all of these qualities, it's a name that has been set to death. It's a name that has been think-pieced to oblivion, and I understand that some people may have some hesitation about it, but that name has to be said, and it is Beto So. Since we're going to talk about Beto, let's talk about some common questions and also some common concern trolling. But he lost! Yes, by 2 points in Texas in an off-year election. And even in doing so, he managed to bring up a lot of Texas Democrats with him. For example, judgeships in Houston and Dallas went from all Republican to all Democratic. Pete Sessions and John Culberson have been sent to the unemployment line, no doubt because of Beto. By the way, there's nothing wrong with being in the unemployment line, unless, of course, your whole life is dedicated to preventing people without money from getting ahead in life, as was the case for John Culberson and Pete Sessions. And then, on a statewide level, you saw a lot of people come surprisingly close to losing, including our monstrously evil, blood-sucking Lieutenant Governor Dan Patrick, who lost by 5 points when previously he was losing by 20. If Beto can do that in Ruby Red, Texas, it's a very significant possibility that he could do the same and cause a landslide for the Democrats across the country. But Texas isn't the rest of the country. Maybe not, but it's kind of most of it. It's such a huge state with so many different demographics of people, so many different types of places, and Beto managed to have a lot of appeal across a lot of those things. So in some ways, it's almost more diverse than the country as a whole, demonstrating his ability to appeal to all kinds of different people. And if he can just maintain his authenticity in a national campaign, I think that he'll have no problem scaling it up. He'll have to change a few elements of his stump speech, like he might have to have 3 a.m. dinner at an Iowa diner instead of Whataburger, but that's a betrayal that I am willing to sustain. But he doesn't have enough experience. Okay, this is the worst concern trolling of all. First of all, Beto has been a U.S. representative for 6 years. That's a national office. He represents hundreds of thousands of people. He just ran one of the most successful campaigns that we've seen in modern political history in the second largest state, both in terms of population and land area. So I would just say to that, take a seat. Secondly, in recent presidential elections, people have gone for the less experienced but more exciting candidate every single time. Trump beat Clinton, Obama beat McCain, Bush beat Gore, Clinton beat Bush. It has been going on for decades now, and we have to recognize the pattern. Experience is totally irrelevant to who can win a presidential election, and so unless you don't care about winning, you really should not bring up experience at this point, especially given, you know, that he reaches a certain bare minimum of qualifications, all right? We're not nominating The Rock, for that matter. Although maybe we are, I guess we'll find out. But winning at all costs is the most important thing. We're not grading LinkedIn profiles, we're stopping fascism. So please, take another seat. Third most, literally, who cares about experience? You don't really care about experience. You're pretending to care about experience because you are fearing that other people in the general election might care about experience. No one cares about experience. What's going to happen is you're going to get into the voting booth and it's going to be Trump versus the Democrat. And no one is going to pick Trump over the Democrat because of an issue of experience. It's just not going to happen. So please, take a third seat, and now you got these 3 seats lined up, maybe take lay down and take a little nap on the futon that you fashioned for yourself, because your arguments are tired. But hey, maybe he does need a stepping stone before he can be president. Can we at least agree that he's qualified to be the vice president? I would love to see Beto up on the debate stage with Mike Pence, look him directly in the eyes and say, "Mr. President, I do believe that women are people." Gets massive applause, hashtag brave Beto. Oh, it would be beautiful. The only argument I'm willing to entertain that Beto shouldn't run for president in 2020 is if you believe that we need him more in the 2020 Senate race against the other incumbent Texas senator and creepy country club looking prospector oil magnate guy John Cornyn, because that would also be a very valuable use of his talents. So I do think that that would be a valid thing for him to do. Regardless, we just got to figure out the best way to capitalize on the Beto-mentum, because I don't think that we've seen a man of his caliber in quite some time, certainly not in Texas Democratic Party politics, and we can't let that go to waste. We should not adhere to traditional political limitations when it comes to determining who the standard bearer of the Democratic Party should be. We can't just limit ourselves to whatever senators and governors have made it, because becoming a senator and governor takes jumping through so many more hoops, and so the likelihood that you're going to have someone who's maintained their integrity all that time is much lower. It also lowers the pool of potentially diverse candidates. So this isn't just about straight white guy Beto O'Rourke. People like Stacey Abrams and Andrew Gillum should be able to have a voice on the national stage because they've inspired so many people, even though their elections were respectively stolen from both of them. Asterisk on Gillum, not yet. Democrats need to stop arbitrarily playing by rules that we made up for ourselves while Republicans actively burn the Constitution. President Trump threw out the playbook a long time ago, and we're not going to win by like digging into the gutter and dripping the dirty swamp water off of it and using the same old tricks. We need to put up the most principled, empathetic, exciting, and frankly sexiest candidate that we can find if we're going to beat him. Whoever it is, I don't care. But personally, I think it's Beto O'Rourke. Now, you might think I'm biased on this subject because I am from Texas and I'm just blindly mesmerized by Beto O'Rourke's adorable Instagram stories featuring his family. But my rebuttal to that is very principled, and that is that, come on, they're so cute! How can you deny? Okay, I think I've covered it all. Whether Beto runs for Senate, VP, or president, I think we can all agree on at least one thing, and that is that our girl Beyonce had better endorse him before Election Day next time, because come on, girl. That's right, I called her out. I am preparing myself for utter online devastation.
No, I won't back down. You can stand me up at the gates of hell, but I won't back down. down.